We have talked about how as we add thermal energy, as we add heat to a system, we can go through the phase changes. We also, as we add heat, once the phase changes have taken place, can warm things up, right? We know we can heat up a glass of water and get it hotter. And we can, of course, remove heat and cool things down. So in this lesson, we're going to be looking at what's called a heating or cooling curve. So let me grab my little mouse here and advance to a curve here. Now, what you see in red, this big line here, let me come over and write on my screen. We see what is called a heating curve, okay? What's happening in this curve as we follow along my little pen is we are adding heat as we're going in this direction. So as we add heat, you might think, well, that means we are raising the temperature, and we are in some cases. But let's say we take a beaker, that's a lovely beaker, and I put some ice cubes in that beaker, and I add a Bunsen burner under it, okay? What's going to happen is I'm going to have this ice cube, and it's going to start, let's say, at a really cold temperature. Let's say this ice cube has gotten out of a really cold freezer at a negative 25 degrees Celsius. It's not going to start melting until we get that ice up to its melting point. So we have to get the ice up to 0 degrees Celsius. So as we first add that thermal energy into there, the temperature can rise as we're adding that heat. But once we get to that 0 degrees Celsius, it's going to start melting, okay? So we're going to start getting a puddle that's forming inside of there. Now, while it's going through that melting process, is the temperature changing? When you look at that graph, do you see the temperature changing? No, it's staying the same. It's staying right at the freezing point. And then, once it's all melted and there isn't any more ice, it is all now just a puddle in the bottom of that beaker, okay? It's just a puddle down there. Then the heat that's going into there is going to be going to turning it, warming that water up. So all the thermal energy going in is warming it up until it all gets up to 100 degrees Celsius. At that point, it'll start boiling, okay? Now there's gonna be some evaporation that's happening all along as soon as you get some liquid water in there. But the boiling is gonna take place when it gets to its boiling temperature. And the whole time it's boiling, if it were pure water, the temperature would maintain at steady temperature. Notice that this line at circle 4 is much longer than this line at circle 2 because it takes a whole lot more energy to do that. Delta H vaporization is what's ruling that line. The delta H fusion is what's ruling this line at number 2. And we know that delta H fusion is always smaller than delta H vaporization, and it's a lot smaller. So all of that thermal energy that's going in as we're adding heat is going to turn it into, the gas phase. It takes a lot to do that. But once we have it all in the gas phase, if we had a way of trapping that vapor into a container up here to where we have water vapor, then that can be converted into, it's steam, that's what we call that. We can raise the temperature of that steam and it could raise above 100 degrees Celsius. So up at the very top of this image, we can see what's happening on the molecular level. The ice is warming. They're starting to move a little bit more. Eventually, they break their attractions and they're sliding past each other. It's warming. They're moving faster and faster until they go into the gas phase. So that's what's happening along those routes. Now, I'm going to erase everything on the screen because some things are going to show up over here on the right-hand side for us to look at next. What we need to be able to do is some calculations for each one of those transitions. Now because, I'll just say it this way. We had mentioned a little bit ago in this chapter that you can measure the heat, and that's what Q stands for. Q is heat. The heat as you change the temperature of a substance using this equation. M is mass, okay? C is called specific heat capacity, and I'm just going to call it heat capacity for short. Specific heat capacity is what it really is. Or maybe I shouldn't call it anything for short. Let's write it out. Can you see this? Specific heat capacity. Sometimes it's just called specific heat. And delta T, delta always stands for change, so this is a change in temperature. So those are the things that will help us determine the energy that goes into a system as it changes temperature. So at circle number one, we would be able to figure out the Q at that with this equation. Then we go through the second phase, number two. At number two, to determine the Q, we're not changing temperature, so we cannot use this equation here. Can't use that equation. So what we do is we take the heat of fusion, which is the amount of heat to convert a mole of solid to a mole of liquid, and multiply by how many moles we have. And then if we went through another change in temperature, that would be at number three, we could use a change in temperature equation again. So that would be Q3. And then if we wanted to go through and measure the heat going through this transition, we would then have to use the heat of vaporization, which is the amount of energy it takes to convert one mole of a liquid to one mole of a gas. So if you took that and multiplied by how many moles you had, you could figure out the energy to go through that transition. And then number five, we're heating it up again, but now we're heating it up as a gas, and we could figure out that heat change. So what we could give you is any substance and ask you to calculate the amount of heat it takes to get it between places, okay? I could start you here, oops, go back down. I could start you here and ask how much energy it takes you to do that, and you would have to do each one of these calculations, and then you would have to add them together, okay? I could start you up here and make you go this way, okay, down to here. And that would be a cooling curve instead of a heating curve. Cooling, okay? Because we're going in the cooling direction, and each one of those states would be negative. They're positive here if you're going in and doing heating, positive values for heating curves, okay? And there'll be negative values if they're cooling curves. Every one of those would be. Okay, so we're going to do an example of this, and here is your problem, and we will work this on the light board. If you are presented with a problem where you're asked to determine how much heat is required to go through a situation where you're changing the phase and you're changing the temperature, then the first thing that you're going to want to do is you're going to want to draw the heating curve. Okay, now how do you draw that? Well, you start down at the bottom and you warm up the solid. Oops, I need to move over. Sorry. You start down at the bottom and you warm up the solid. And then you melt it. And then you warm up the liquid, and then you boil it, and then you warm up the gas. So that would be what you'd want to draw out first. Now, if it's water, H2O, and that's what we're dealing with here, is H2O. If it's H2O, then you would know that this happens at zero, and I'm writing over here again, I've got to keep in mind where I am. This is happening at 0 degrees Celsius, that's where this line is happening, and this line is happening at 100 degrees Celsius. But if it wasn't water, you would need to record the melting point of the thing you're dealing with. Is it nitrogen? Is it argon? What is it? You put whatever temperature it freezes at in, whatever temperature it boils at in, to mark this, because going along this axis is temperature. Okay, we have our temperature going there. So you read the problem and you say, okay, there is phase changes and temperature changes taking place in this problem. I'm going to write this out. I'm going to label this and I'm going to label this, and then I'll go back to reading the problem. So we go back to reading the problem. And we're going to start with 100 grams of ice, no, 100 grams of water. And we're going to go from 0 degrees to steam at 125. So let's start with water at 0 degrees. And let's figure out where this is on the graph that we have constructed here. The solid is this state right here. This is when it's in the solid state. This is when it's in the liquid state. And this is when it's in the gas state. So we are liquid. So we know we're somewhere on here. And we're liquid at 0 degrees Celsius. So right here is where we're going to start our calculation. If it said it was ice at 0 degrees Celsius, which this one didn't, if it was ice, we know that ice is the solid, and we would start right here at 0 degrees Celsius. But this specifically says we are water, that's the liquid phase, and at 0 degrees Celsius. Okay, and we're going to go until we are steam. Now, steam is a name for water in the gas phase. We are steam at 125. This is steam at 100. So steam at 125 is somewhere up on this line. So let's just say that this is 125. Well, you can't read that whatsoever. Where is my eraser when I need it? Go away. All right, so we're somewhere along here at 125 degrees Celsius. That's where we're going to stop. So I've read the problem, I know where I'm starting, and I know where I'm stopping, and I've got to figure out what calculations I will need to do. Every line is a calculation. So I'm going to start here, and my first calculation will take me through that line, and I'm going to label it with a number 1. What's happening here? Liquid, or the water, is warming up from 0 up to 100 degrees Celsius. Once I get to the end of this line and there's a bend, I know that's my next calculation. So this will be my calculation number 2. What's happening here? The liquid is turning into a gas. I'm going to be vaporizing it. And then I'm ready for my last leg of the journey. It's going to go from 0 up to 125 degrees Celsius. I'm changing temperatures, and that's going to be the third leg of my journey. I will calculate this part. I will calculate this part, I will calculate this part, and then add them together, and that will give me the value that I have for the amount of energy it takes to do what they're asking. So let's do each step along the way. Step number 1. Step number 1 is a change of temperature. Anytime I'm wanting to determine a change in temperature, I'm going to use the equation mC sub s delta T. So what's the mass of the water? I have 100 grams of it. What is my specific heat capacity of water? That would be the liquid state. So I look at the data they give me, and I see that it's 4.184 joules per gram degree Celsius. So now I have the C sub S, and then I have the delta T. This is a place that I see more students messing up than any. They go over there and find those two temperatures. You're not doing the full thing here. You're doing only this leg of the journey. What are the two temperatures on this leg of the journey? It's starting out at 0 degrees Celsius. It's going up to here, which is 100 degrees Celsius. Those are the two temperatures I need to do, final minus initial. 100 degrees Celsius minus 0 degrees Celsius. And I can work with Celsius here, okay? I don't have to work with Kelvin. But a change in temperature in Kelvin and a change in temperature of Celsius are exactly the same change. So it doesn't matter. They give it to you in Kelvin, its change is exactly numerically the same. So I will multiply those three values together. And when I do, I get 4.184 times 10 to the, let's see, fourth joules. All right, so that's Q1. Ready for Q2. All right, the second leg of the journey. For the second leg of the journey, I am boiling it. I am converting it to a gas, so delta H of vaporization is what I need. Now, I told you it's vaporization is that times moles will give me the value. Let's see why that is. If I look at the value of heat of vaporization, it's 40.68, and what are the units? Kilojoule per mole. I don't have a mole. I have 100 grams, so I better figure out how many moles that is. I'm going to do that within the problem, okay? If I have 100 grams and I don't really want grams, but I want moles, I just need to divide by that value, okay? So 40 times this many moles will give me the delta H of vaporization, and in this case, the value, look at the units, it's going to be in kilojoules, is 225.8, and the unit is kilojoules. Okay? So that's the second leg of the journey. Now I'm ready for the third leg of the journey. All of these are positive because we're putting heat in. It's endothermic, putting in heat, putting in heat. So the last leg of the journey is a change in temperature again. Okay, to get this for that leg of the journey, we are, and by the way, I'm going to call this Q2 equals, okay? Q3 equals the mass, okay, it's still 100 grams. The specific heat of, now what's the state here? It's steam, it's gas phase. So H2O gas is 2.01 joules per gram degrees Celsius. And on this leg of the journey, the final is 125 degrees Celsius, and the initial is 100 degrees Celsius. So when I multiply those values together with that change, I get 5.025. Now that's an extra significant figure, so I'm going to call it 5.03, and that's going to be joules. I'm sorry, it is not that. 5.0, it's in joules, 2.5. I'd already converted to kilojoules in my mind. So this is how many joules it is, 5,025 joules. So I know each leg of the journey, but I want to know the total. What is the total amount of heat required to do this? Well, I can't add these three numbers up. Why not? Well, this is in joules, this is in kilojoules, and this is in joules. They have to be in the same unit to add them up. So I'm going to go ahead and convert this joule to kilojoule. 1 kilojoule is 1,000 joules. That is going to be 41.84 kilojoules. This is already in kilojoules. I'm going to take this and convert it to kilojoules. 1 kilojoule divided by 1,000 is going to be 5.025. Okay? Now I am ready, and that's kilojoules. I am now ready to add those three values up. So I have the 41.84, and that's kilojoules, plus the 225.8 kilojoules plus the 5.025 kilojoules. And when we add those values together, we will get 272.7 kilojoules. Now, a word about sig figs. We're multiplying here. We really only know it to three. That'd be one decimal place. We have four. And we only know this to three, so we really only know three, so we would only have no decimal points. We know this one with three, so we can know it to three, that's two decimal points. So one decimal point, no decimal points, two decimal points, we can only know this to no decimal points. So with the right number of significant figures, that would be 273 kilojoules total to undergo this process. So let's talk just a little bit about things to watch for if you're asked to do a problem like this. If it's not water, you don't have 0 and 100 degrees to shoot at. You've got to write down those values. That's one thing. They'll never set you down in the middle of one of these lines that are horizontal because you don't know how to work with partial boiling, okay? It's hard to know at what point are we done boiling. So we'll run all the way through those lines always, but you could do a partial change in temperature. The other thing that you need to watch is if you're not putting thermal energy in and heating it up and you're doing a cooling curve instead, you could flip the whole thing around or you could just say, I'm going this way, but no, and put a note down that every one of these steps need to be negative. Now, why would this one be negative? Because when you did final minus initial, these things would be reversed and be negative. Why would this one be negative? Because definition of delta H vaporization is going this way. If you reverse the process, it changes the sign, okay? So that each one of those legs would be negative and the total heat would be a negative value. So those are things to watch out for if you're doing some complex heating and cooling curve problems.